So today we'll start with the periodontal pocket topic. So before that, we'll learn about some important aspects of gingiva. So in the gingiva, we have macroscopic and microscopic anatomy. So macroscopic is clinically what we see without the aid of microscope. What we see clinically is the macroscopic feature. In this, we have marginal gingiva, attached gingiva, and the interdental papilla. Okay, so macroscopically, the gingiva, anatomically, we divide the gingiva into three parts, marginal gingiva, attached gingiva, and the interdental papilla. Whereas microscopically, again, the gingiva is divided into three parts. That is the oral epithelium, sulcular epithelium, and the junctional epithelium. So what is oral epithelium? The gingival epithelium that is lining the crest of the gingiva, marginal gingiva, and the attached gingiva. So the outer part of the epithelium is called as oral epithelium. Whereas the gingival epithelium that is lining the sulcus, gingival sulcus, is called as sulcular epithelium. Okay, so now what is sulcus? It's a V-shaped crevice that is present in between the tooth surface and the sulcular epithelium, that is the marginal gingiva. So the sulcular epithelium is covering the marginal gingiva. Okay, so now the sulcular epithelium lines the sulcus. Okay, so the sulcus is a V-shaped groove in between the tooth surface and the marginal gingiva. The epithelium that is lining the sulcus is called as sulcular epithelium. Now, beneath this sulcular epithelium, we have the junctional epithelium. This whole thing is the junctional epithelium. So this junctional epithelium is attaching to the tooth surface. It is forming an attachment to the tooth surface. Okay, so there is something called as dentogingival unit. The junctional epithelium along with the gingival fibers form the dentogingival unit. So this is how the whole gingiva is attached to the tooth surface. Okay, with this basic knowledge, we'll move on to the next part, that is a periodontal pocket. So what is pocket? It is defined as a pathologically deepened gingival sulcus. Okay, so now the gingival sulcus, which we have seen, that is the V-shaped groove, is now deepened. So this V-shaped groove is deepened. The junctional epithelium is no longer here. It has moved apically. Okay, so this is called as pocket. So this is one of the most important clinical features of the periodontal disease. So here in the first picture, you can see this is the sulcus. So the sulcus depth is 2 to 3 mm. So ideally in notobiotic animals, in germ-free animals, the sulcus depth should be 0 mm. But this is not possible. Germ-free condition is not possible. So usually in humans, it is 2 to 3 mm. So if it exceeds, if this deepening of the sulcus takes place, that is greater than 3 mm, then it is called as pocket. So here you can see the sulcus has deepened. The junctional epithelium, which should be somewhere here, has migrated apically. So that is why you need to remember where the junctional epithelium is. So now this whole part is covered by the sulcular epithelium only. The junctional epithelium has migrated apically, resulting in the formation of periodontal pocket. So now, why does this pocket occur? This may occur because of the coronal movement of the gingival margin. So pocket is deepened gingival sulcus. Okay, so deepened gingival sulcus. Okay, so why is this deepening taking place? It might be because the gingiva, which should be present here, might have moved coronally. Okay, so because of its movement coronally, again, the gingival sulcus depth is increasing, right? So pocket may occur because of the coronal movement of the gingival margin, or it may occur because the junctional epithelium, the epithelial attachment, has migrated apically. Okay, so it may occur because of the movement of the gingival margin coronally, or it may occur because of the apical displacement of the gingival attachment. So here you can see the attachment is here, but here in the second picture, it has moved apically. So from here to here, it has moved from here to here. So it might be because of the coronal movement of the gingival margin, or apical displacement of the gingival attachment, or it can be combination of both the coronal movement as well as the apical displacement. So here we have a classification. This is very important. So in this, there are two types of pockets, that is the gingival pocket and the periodontal pocket. The gingival pocket is called as pseudo pocket. So why is it called as pseudo pocket? In pseudo pocket, there is no loss of periodontal attachment, no loss of periodontal attachment. So here, the gingiva, the epithelial attachment is intact. There is nothing wrong with the epithelial attachment. Only the gingival margin, which has to stay here, it is migrating coronally. So there is no loss of epithelial attachment. So that is why it is called as pseudo pocket. Whereas periodontal pocket is called as absolute or a true pocket. When do we call a true pocket? If we call it as a true pocket, if we call it as a periodontal pocket, then there should be loss of periodontal attachment. Okay, so gingival pocket is because of the coronal movement of the gingival margin, whereas periodontal pocket is because of the apical displacement of the epithelial attachment. Hope everyone is clear with this. In periodontal pocket, we have again two types, the supra bony pocket and the intra bony pocket. Supra means above, bony means bone. Okay, supra bony, it is above the bone. So here in this B picture, if you can see the pocket, see the epithelial attachment has migrated. It should be here, but it has migrated till here. The epithelial attachment has shifted apically. Now, where is the bone? Bone is here. Okay, so now the base of the pocket, so this will be the, when you place a periodontal probe, the base of the pocket is here, right? The base of the pocket is above the bone, above the alveolar bone. So this is called as supraboni. The base of the pocket is coronal to the alveolar bone. This is called as supraboni or supracrestal or supraalveolar. Whereas in case of intraboni, this base of the pocket is apical to the level of alveolar bone, isn't it? So the base of the pocket is apical to the alveolar bone. That is why it is called as intrabony, intrabony, subcrestal or intraalveolar. Okay, now let's see the differences in between this suprabony pocket and intrabony pocket. Okay, so the important question from MCQ point of view is, if there is no loss of periodontal attachment, then it is called as a gingival pocket or a pseudo pocket. If it is a true pocket, then there will be the loss of attachment, periodontal attachment. Okay, so now supraboni, as we all know, the base of the pocket is coronal to the level of alveolar bone. So if this is the pocket epithelium, the base of the pocket is coronal to the level of alveolar bone. Whereas in case of intraboni pocket, the base of the pocket is, the base of the pocket is apical to the level of alveolar bone. In case of supraboni pocket, there will be horizontal bone destruction. Whereas in case of intraboni pocket, there is vertical bone destruction. So why is this taking place? In case of intraboni pocket, where is the location of intraboni pocket? The base of the pocket, this intraboni pocket is in between the tooth surface and the alveolar bone, isn't it? So if the pocket is intraboni, it is involving the periodontal attachment and some amount of bone also, isn't it? So that is why vertical kind of bone defects are created. Whereas in case of supraboni pocket, everything is shifting apically. So here the bone is horizontal, the periodontal ligament, alveolar bone, everything is migrating apically. So its position is just migrating apically. There is no change, but they are migrating apically. So that is why there is horizontal bone destruction. Whereas in intraboni pocket, there is vertical bone destruction. In case of supraboni pocket, so you have to remember, supraboni, it will be horizontal, intraboni, it will be vertical. So transeptal fibers are also arranged intraboni pocket. They are arranged obliquely. Okay, next, the pedial fibers will follow again the horizontal oblique course in case of supraboni pocket, whereas in case of intraboni pocket, they follow an angular course. Okay, so here in case of supraboni pocket, the periodontal ligament and the alveolar crest are gradually attaining an apical position in relation to the tooth surface. But their original morphology and architecture, they are same. That is why horizontal bone destruction is taking place. Okay, next. So as I've already told you, if we call it as a true periodontal pocket, then there should be attachment loss. There should be apical migration of the junctional epithelium, and there should be the transformation of the junctional epithelium to a pocket epithelium. It's the same thing actually. So there should be attachment loss. So there should be the apical migration of the junctional epithelium and the transformation of the junctional epithelium to a pocket epithelium. There is another classification for this pocket, that is simple pocket, compound pocket, and complex pocket. Okay, in case of simple pocket, the pocket is involving only one surface, that is called as a simple pocket, whereas compound pocket, it involves greater than one surface. Okay, so more than one surface. So here you can see it is involving two surfaces. Okay, simple pocket is, suppose there is pocket only on the mesial aspect of a tooth, okay, in the interproximal area. Suppose in the compound pocket, there is a pocket even on the facial aspect as well as on the mesial aspect, more than one surface. Whereas in case of a complex or a spiral pocket, the pocket is originating on one tooth surface. It is twisting and involving another tooth surface. So the axis is not straight like this. Okay, so it is starting on one tooth surface. It is twisting and involving another tooth surface. This is called as a complex or a spiral pocket. Next, we'll see the clinical features. Okay, so the area wherein we have the pocket will appear bluish red, and the marginal gingiva is thickened in that region. So why is it bluish red? Bluish red is nothing but the chronic inflammation. Okay, pockets are a result of the chronic inflammation. So that is why they appear bluish red. So there is a bluish red vertical zone from the gingival margin to the alveolar mucosa. So a tooth is like this. From the gingival margin, from the marginal gingiva to the alveolar mucosa, there will be a bluish red vertical zone. There will be gingival bleeding, suppuration, or both bleeding and suppuration. Suppuration is pus formation. And there might be tooth mobility. So because why is there the tooth mobility? Because the attachment is lost. The periodontal attachment is lost, because of which the tooth will become mobile. So there is bone loss, there is loss of the periodontal ligament, because of which the tooth will become mobile. And there might be diastema formation. Next, symptoms. So there might be localized pain in the region where the pocket is present, or this might be called as a pain deep in the bone or radiating kind of pain. And there might be foul taste in the localized area. This is because pockets form an ideal area for the food accumulation. And they are most difficult to clean. Okay, so that is why they will result in more food accumulation, because of which foul taste results. Okay, and seen, even toothache is seen even in the absence of caries. Next, and even another symptom is patients will have the urge to dig. Wherever the pocket is there, patients will have the urge to dig. Now, pockets are there. How to detect pockets? The accurate method of detecting is using a periodontal probe. So there are different kinds of probes which will be covered in your periodontal instruments topic. So there is a periodontal probe which we use to detect the pockets. Or else we can use the gutta percha points or calibrated silver points, and we can take radiographs. Okay, so but the most accurate method and the most commonly used method is using a periodontal probe. We can even use the gutta percha points or the calibrated silver points. We have to place it in the area where the pocket is there, and we can take radiographs. Next, this is just for you to understand. So first picture shows the healthy gingiva. This pink part is the junctional epithelium. Okay, this is the junctional epithelium. So in case of healthy gingiva, when you place a probe tip into the sulcus, then the probe tip will remain in the junctional epithelium. It will be stopped at the junctional epithelium. Okay. Whereas in case of gingivitis, the probe tip is penetrating the junctional epithelium. But there are collagen fibers here. Since it's only gingivitis, there is no loss of attachment here. Okay. So the collagen fibers are stopping the probe from entering deep. Whereas in case of periodontitis, the probe is perforating the junctional epithelium. The collagen fibers are not present now because the attachment loss has taken place. The collagen fibers are destroyed. Collagen fibers are destroyed, because of which the probe easily perforates the junctional epithelium. And where will we have the resistance? At the alveolar bone. So the probe is stopped only by the contact with the alveolar bone. Whereas in case of gingivitis, the probe is stopped when it is encountering the collagen fibers. Next, we'll see the pathogenesis. So how is the pocket forming? The main important thing is the bacterial challenge. Okay. So in case of healthy conditions, there will be some amount of bacteria like coccoids and straight rods. Okay. So the main thing to develop this pocket is the inflammation of the gingiva to the bacterial challenge. So to the bacteria, there is response of our host, okay, response of the gingiva to that bacteria. So what will happen? What is that response? It's an inflammatory response, okay? So to the bacterial challenge, there will be some amount of inflammation that is seen in the connective tissue wall of the sulcus, okay? So what is this inflammatory change? During this inflammatory change, there are collagenases that are secreted. These collagenases are secreted by the host cells as well as the inflammatory cells. So the collagenases are secreted by certain cells like fibroblasts, PMNs, and macrophages. Okay, so first there is bacterial challenge. Because of this bacteria, the bacteria have started accumulating in the sulcus area. Okay, so to which the inflammatory changes have started. So once the bacteria starts accumulating, our body has to react, right? So it is showing the response in the form of inflammation. So during this inflammation, collagenases are secreted by host cells as well as the inflammatory cells like fibroblasts, polymorphonuclear neutrophils, and the macrophages. And the fibroblasts will start phagocytosing the collagen fibers. So this is the fibroblast. Okay, so these fibroblasts will extend its processes at the junction of the where the collagen fibers are present. So this fibroblast will start extending their cytoplasmic processes to the junction of the cementum and the periodontal ligament. So if this is tooth structure, this is cementum, periodontal ligament fibers will be there, bone will be there, here there is gingiva. So the fibroblast will extend their cytoplasmic process at the bone and the periodontal ligament junction, and they will destroy the collagen fibers that are present. Now, finally, what happens? Collagenases are, again, they are proteinases that are destroying collagen. So finally, because of these two processes, there is loss of collagen. Once there is loss of collagen, what is happening? So here the attachment is because of this collagen fibers. Once the collagen fibers are lost, the junctional epithelium starts proliferating apically. The junctional epithelium is now moving apically. So later, once it starts moving apically, the polymorphonuclear neutrophils come and they invade the coronal part of the junctional epithelium. Okay, so here, so this is the bone, this is the cementum, okay, cementum, this is the periodontal ligament. So now what is happening? This collagen fibers are getting lost. So this coronal portion is intact, whereas the apical portion, it is proliferating. Okay, the junctional epithelium is proliferating apically. Later, PMNs will come and they start invading the coronal aspect. They start entering the coronal part. Now, once the PMNs will become, once the relative concentration of the PMNs will become greater than 60%, then this coronal portion of the junctional epithelium detaches and it will also migrate apically. You understood? First, the apical part is proliferating. Later, coronal part is detaching. Okay, so because of the response to the bacteria, inflammatory changes are taking place. During this inflammatory changes, collagenases are secreted, which will destroy the collagen fibers. And the fibroblasts are also phagocytosing the collagen fibers. Later, the junctional epithelium is proliferating apically. And after that, the PMNs will come and invade the coronal aspect of the sulcus. Once these PMNs are greater than 60%, the junctional epithelium will lose its cohesiveness. It will lose its attachment. So coronally, it starts detaching. So finally, what is the result? The junctional epithelium being migrated apically. So there is loss of attachment. This whole thing, there is loss of attachment. Now let's see the histopathology. So in histopathology, we should study in two aspects, the soft tissue wall of the pocket and the hard tissue wall. So where is the pocket now? The pocket is here. So pocket, there is hard tissue wall, that is a tooth surface, cementum surface, whereas a soft tissue wall. Okay, so in the soft tissue wall, the connective tissue is edematous and it is infiltrated with plasma cells. Approximately 80% of the cells are plasma cells. Remember, during the formation of the pocket, we had greater than 60% of the neutrophils. But after the pocket formation, we have the plasma cells, which are abundant. Okay, and there are lymphocytes, there are TMNs also. But the principal cells here after the pocket formation are the plasma cells. Okay, the blood vessels increase in number, they become dilated, they become engorged. That means they become swollen and they become increased in size. Next, the connective tissue exhibits varying degrees of degeneration. An important MCQ for you is, in the histopathology of the pocket, we see both the proliferative changes as well as the degenerative changes. So this question is asked, both proliferative changes are seen as well as degenerative changes are also seen. So in case of proliferative changes, we see the formation of endothelial cells, new capillaries. So all these are formed. Along with that, some amount of degenerative changes are also seen. So now what is happening? The junctional epithelium is migrating apically. Coronally, there is detachment taking place. Now the junctional epithelium is migrating apically. So what is happening to the junctional epithelium? It is becoming shorter than that of its original length. It is becoming shorter than that of the normal sulcus. So it is reduced to a height of 50 to 100 micrometer. What is its original height? It is 500 micrometer. So this 500 micrometer is getting reduced to 50 to 100 micrometer. So the most severe degenerative changes are taking place along the lateral wall of the pocket. So this lateral wall of the pocket, we see severe degenerative changes when compared to the point beneath the base of the pocket. The lateral wall of the pocket is showing severe degenerative changes. Okay, and the epithelial cells are extending some cords. Interlacing cords or epithelial buds are projecting into the connective tissue. So this lateral wall of the pocket is showing most degenerative changes, and here the epithelial cells are extending, they are projecting into the connective tissue. Now we have seen the clinical features and the histopathological features. Let's see the correlation in between them. So we have seen that there is bluish red discoloration. Okay, so why is the bluish red discoloration seen? It is because of the circulatory stagnation. So we have seen that this bluish red discoloration is a feature of chronic inflammation. So because of the chronic inflammation, there is circulatory stagnation, because of which we see the bluish red discoloration. There is flaccidity, that means lack of firmness. Okay, so gingiva, you should be firm, right? So it is becoming flaccid. There is lack of firmness. Why is there lack of firmness? Because the gingival fibers, the collagen fibers are destroyed, because of which we see flaccidity. And there is smooth and shiny surface. This is because of the atrophy of the epithelium and edematous changes. And there is spitting on pressure. This is also because of edema and degeneration. So we have seen that we have proliferative changes and we have degenerative changes. Okay, so there are two types of pockets again here: edematous pockets and fibrotic pockets. In case of edematous pockets, the degenerative changes are dominating. Okay, so there is more amount of edema, more amount of inflammatory cells, because of which edematous changes are dominating. So edema, there's spitting on pressure, smooth, shiny surface, everything is getting dominated. Whereas in case of fibrotic changes, there is, in case of fibrotic, what is happening is there is proliferation. Okay, so there is appearance of new capillaries, endothelial cells, and therefore the gingiva is firm. So sometimes what happens is the gingiva is firm and pink on the outer side, whereas the inflammatory changes are present on the inner side of the pocket wall. So if this is the pocket, the outer surface is healthy, whereas the inner aspect of the pocket is showing inflammatory changes. So on the outer side, the gingiva appears healthy because it is pink. But inner side, there will be the edematous changes, the inflammatory changes going on. Okay, so if fibrotic changes are dominating, then you may see firm and pink gingival wall. Whereas if you see the edematous changes dominating, then you won't see the firmness, you will see the flaccidity, right? Then there will be bleeding, as we have seen. This is because of the increased vascularity. So we have seen that the blood vessels are increasing in size, they are dilating, right? So because of which we are seeing the bleeding. and the atrophy of the epithelium is seen, isn't it? So the epithelial layer is getting atrophied. Therefore, the connective tissue is getting exposed, because of which there is ulceration. Since there is ulceration, there is painful inner aspect of the pocket. So the inner aspect of the pocket is painful. And sometimes pus may be expressed. Okay, when you apply the digital pressure, there might be suppurative changes. Next, we'll look into the microtopography of the gingival wall of the pocket. So here we have seven areas. The first one is the area of relative quiescence. So this, from this, the questions have not been asked, but let's just have an idea about this. Okay. So in this area of relative quiescence, quiescence means it is inactive. Okay. So the area is inactive. So there will be some depressions and mounds in this area. Okay, so on this we are studying in the gingival wall of the pocket. So once we see, take a section of the gingival wall of the pocket and study, so there will be area of relative quiescence. That means these are the inactive areas. They have the depressions and mounds. And next, there will be areas of bacterial accumulation. So in these inactive areas, the bacteria started entering. So there will be bacteria and debris. Okay, so this area of bacterial accumulation is getting dominated by bacteria and debris. Next, there will be area of emergence of leukocytes. Here, these leukocytes will start entering from the holes that are present in the intercellular spaces. So in between the cells, we have the intercellular spaces. Through these intercellular spaces, the leukocytes will start emerging. Next, the leukocytes and the bacteria will start interacting. These are the areas of leukocyte-bacteria interaction. In this area, what we see is we see leukocytes that are surrounded by bacteria, that are covered by bacteria. So this will give an indication of phagocytosis. Okay, so the leukocytes are trying to phagocytose the bacteria. Next, there are areas of intense epithelial desquamation. So here we see semi-attached and folded epithelial squams. Okay, next we see the areas of ulceration. This is because the epithelium is lost. There is atrophy of the epithelium, because of which the connective tissue is getting exposed, and we see areas of ulceration. Last one is the areas of hemorrhage, wherein we see erythrocytes. So in order to easily remember this particular sequence, you need to understand a concept. So first, the area is inactive. That is, the area is quiescent. Later, the bacteria started accumulating in that area, after which there is emergence of the leukocytes. The leukocytes are coming outside in order to interact with the bacteria. So now the leukocytes have come. Later, the leukocytes and the bacteria started interacting. Okay, next. After this interaction, the epithelium is getting desquamated. The epithelium is getting atrophied. There is intense epithelial desquamation. Finally, there is ulceration. Since the epithelium is removed, the connective tissue is exposed. So there is ulceration. And finally, there is, so you can see, so this is the area of quiescence, wherein you can see some depressions and mounds. So here in this area, you can see, you cannot clearly appreciate, but there is emergence of bacteria in this area. And here you can see that the leukocyte bacteria interaction, that means there are leukocytes which are covered by large amount of bacteria, stating that the leukocytes are trying to phagocytose the bacteria. Okay.
Ramya, can you please explain this picture again?
This one, sir?
Yes.
Yeah. So this is just a scanning electron microscopy photography. So just for the understanding, first is the area of relative quiescence. That means this area is inactive. Okay. In the inactive area, we have seen that we have depressions and mounds. We have depressions and mounds, and there will be some shedding of the cells in this area. So here we are showing this area of relative, A representing area of relative quiescence, wherein we can see some elevations and depressions. Okay. So next phase is the area of bacterial accumulation. So here we can see that some of these white things are the bacteria, this irregular things. So now in this areas of relative quiescence, the bacteria are entering. The bacteria started entering. Whereas in the next step, we are seeing that there are some cells which are covered by bacteria, these white things. Okay. So this is the area where the leukocyte and the bacteria are interacting. Leukocyte and bacterial interaction is taking place. Okay, this is the scanning electron microscopy photography. Whereas this is actually not clear, but just for understanding, I have placed this. So this area representing the depressions in mounts, this area representing the emergence of bacteria, and this area representing the interaction in between the leukocytes and the bacteria. That's it.
Okay, fine.
Next, we'll see the contents of the pocket. So what is present in the pocket? So this is again an important MCQ. The pocket is principally having the microorganisms and their products. So microorganisms and debris is present in the pocket. So what are the products of microorganisms? It contains enzymes, endotoxins, and metabolic products. So the endotoxins, enzymes, whatever are released by the bacteria, whatever are released by the microorganisms are present. The microorganisms and their products. Next, we have the gingival fluid. Okay, we have the gingival crevicular fluid that is emerging. We have the food remnants. We have salivary mucin, despermated epithelial cells. So all these are not asked in your MCQ. It is only asked that microorganisms are present in the pocket. Okay, so there will be leukocytes, plaque-covered calculus that is projecting from the tooth surface. So if we have tooth surface like this, this calculus will be there. Again, I'll be talking about the zones later, but here there will be calculus. This calculus, remember, calculus will always be covered by a layer of plaque. Calculus is never plaque-free. So if we have calculus, it is always covered by a layer of plaque. So this calculus is covered by plaque. So in the gingival wall, we see the plaque-covered calculus that is projecting on the tooth surface. Okay, the plaque-covered calculus that is usually projecting on the tooth surface. We have the purulent exudate having living, degenerated, and necrotic leukocytes. We have the living and dead bacteria. Serum is there and scant amount of fibrin is present. Now, we have seen that pus may be seen in the pocket. Okay, so, but sometimes, like, I mean, people assume that if there is pus, it means severe infection. Okay, but it is not the case. Pus is only a secondary sign. Pus is only indicating that inflammatory changes are dominating. There are more amount of inflammatory changes. Okay, so we have seen that edematous changes and fibrotic changes. So if edematous changes are dominating the fibrotic changes, so then we may see the pus formation. So pus formation does not indicate that there is severe periodontal destruction. The pus only reflects the nature of inflammatory changes that are going in the pocket wall. It does not indicate the depth of the pocket or severity of the periodontal destruction. So in some cases, we have deep pockets, which may not show pus. In some cases, we have shallow pockets, which may exhibit pus. So pocket, this pus formation is not indicating the depth of the pocket, neither the severity of the periodontal destruction. It is only a secondary sign. This is again an important MCQ. Pus is only reflecting the nature of the inflammatory changes that are going on in the pocket wall. That is, whether inflammatory changes are predominating or fibrotic changes are predominating. That's it. Next. Now, we have seen the gingival wall of the pocket. Now, let's see the root surface wall of the pocket. Okay. The reason why I am drawing for everything is you should not get confused about what we are talking. So, this is the gingival wall of the pocket. This is pocket, right? So, you're placing the probe here. This is pocket. Okay. So, this is the probe that we are placing. This is the gingival wall of the pocket. This is the root surface wall of the pocket. So, this root surface wall is having pathologic granules, which are depicting the areas of collagen destruction. There will be necrotic cementum in that area. So now here the attachment is lost. Now the cementum is exposed to a lot of bacteria, resulting in the formation of a necrotic cementum. So previously it was advised that this necrotic cementum has to be removed during the scaling and root planning procedure. But previously what it was advised is this necrotic cementum has to be completely removed until the dentin is exposed. Okay, so if the soft infected dentin has to be removed, but no longer this is advised. Okay, this is not advised now. Only the necrotic cementum removal is not advised right now. Okay, and this root surface wall is also having the endotoxins. Where are these endotoxins arising from? They are arising from the bacteria. This is again an important MCQ. So in the root surface wall, we are having some pathologic granules, which are indicating the areas where the collagen destruction has taken place, isn't it? So this is the area where the collagen fibers have to be present. So they should be attaching to the bone surface, but they have lost, they are destroyed. So these areas are represented as pathologic granules. These minerals that are increased and exposed to cementum are the calcium.
Start preparing for the NEET MDS from your home. Dr. Pranab Academy of Dental Sciences. Online classes for all first, second, third and final year students. NEET MDS online test series, unlimited practice and highest quality teaching. Affordable pricing. Download the app now.
Okay. So in the remineralization areas, there is the mineral content that is increased, having greater amount of calcium, magnesium, phosphorus and fluoride. Or there might be demineralization also. So in this demineralization, we have the root caries formation. Okay, and the common organism that is involved in this root caries is Actinomyces viscosus. So this is again an important question. So on the root surface wall, we may have the area of demineralization or the area of remineralization. So because of the bacterial plaque, because of exposure to the oral fluid, there might be proteolysis resulting in the demineralization areas. Now we'll see the microtopography of the root surface wall. Okay, so we are talking about this part now, the root surface. Okay, so on this, the first area is the area where the calculus is present. So as I've already told you, the calculus is never free of plaque. If there is calculus, there is layer of, if there is calculus, there is a layer of plaque that is always attached to it. So the second layer will be attached plaque. So there is the plaque that is attached to the layer of calculus. Next, we have unattached plaque. Okay, so first one is the calculus. Next is the attached plaque. And this attached plaque will extend to a level of like 100 to 500 micrometer. Okay, so this attached plaque extends from 100 to 500 meters from the calculus. Third layer is the zone of plaque. So this unattached plaque is beneath the attached plaque. Okay, so it is surrounding the attached plaque and it is extending apically. Third, fourth area, we have the junctional epithelium attachment. So the junctional epithelium has extended apically. Okay, so all these should not be present. The calculus, attached plaque, unattached plaque should not be present. The junctional epithelium should be somewhere. But because of all these bacterial deposits, the junctional epithelial attachment is now here. And beneath the junctional epithelial attachment, we have the partially lysed connective tissue fibers. Later, we have the intact tissue fibers. So now, I'll talk about chronic inflammation, right? So in any case of chronic inflammation, there will be periods of activity and periods of inactivity. So previously, it was thought that the process of periodontitis, the periodontal disease, is slow and continuous. It will progress just like that. Okay, just it will progress continuously. But it was later realized that there are periods of inactivity and periods of activity. So suddenly it is progressing. Later it is getting inactive. Again it is progressing. Again it is getting inactive. So the periodontal disease activity constitutes periods of remissions and periods of exacerbations. This is again a question. Okay, chronic periodontal disease has the periods of remissions and exacerbations. So what is this period of inactivity called? It is the period of quiescence. Same thing we have seen in that soft tissue wall. Okay, the area of relative quiescence. So first it is quiescent, it is silent. Okay, so this period of quiescence is characterized by reduced inflammatory response. So the inflammation is at a lower level. And here, there is little or no loss of bone and connective tissue. Okay, whereas the period of exacerbation means exacerbating. So there is activity that is going on. There is a lot of destruction that is going on. So here, the bone and connective tissue attachment are lost and the pocket is deepening. So periodontal pockets go through periods of exacerbations and periods of quiescence. That is the periods of remissions and exacerbations. Now, there are some pulp changes that are associated with the periodontal pockets. So how is the pulp and periodontal pocket getting connected? So this is the pulp. This is the periodontal bone and the periodontal attachment. So this pulp and periodontal attachment are also getting connected through apical foramina or through lateral foramina or the accessory canals. Okay, so the periodontal infection may also cause pathologic changes in the pulp. So it may give rise to painful symptoms, or it may affect the response of the pulp to restorative procedures. So how is this link taking place? It may be either through the apical foramina. So the periodontal infection is extending and it is going from the apical foramina to the pulp, or the periodontal infection is extending through the lateral canals and it is affecting the pulp. So there are two channels, the apical foramina or the lateral canals. Now, this is again an important point. Relationship of the attachment loss and bone loss to pocket tip. Okay, so here this picture is showing the, here there is same attachment loss. Okay, so here in this, the gingival margin is at a normal level and there is some pocket tip. How are we measuring the pocket tip? Base of the pocket to the gingival margin. Okay, so the place where the resistance of the probe is felt, that is the base of the pocket to the gingival margin. Here we are having some amount of attachment. In this B picture also, we are having the same attachment loss, but there is recession of the gingival margin. Okay, whereas in the C picture, there is severe recession of the gingival margin and there is pocket also. Okay, so in this case, in the C case, what you will do to calculate the attachment loss, you will calculate the pocket depth first. Pocket depth is from base of the pocket to the base of pocket. Okay, now what is the depth of the recession?
Please,
it is from the cemento enamel junction to the gingival.
Ramya, can you hear me?
Yeah, sir.
You were not audible.
Hello.
Yeah,
sir, I'm able to hear you.
When you were explaining this, so please, I think this is a very important, important part of the topic. So please explain it again. You were not audible for some moments. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Please explain it again. This thing.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yeah. So in the third picture, that is the C picture, what we are seeing is there is recession. Along with that, there is pocket also. So in such cases, if you calculate pocket depth, what is pocket depth? Pocket depth is from the base of the pocket to the gingival margin. So pocket depth is from the base of the pocket to the gingival margin. Whereas recession is from the cemento enamel junction to the gingival margin. Okay, so this is the recession depth. So now if you have to calculate the attachment loss in this case, then you have to add these two, the probing depth plus the recession depth. Okay, so if there is recession, you have to add the, I mean, for calculating attachment loss, you have to add the probing depth plus recession depth. Okay, if suppose there is gingival enlargement, then you have to subtract the probing depth minus the enlargement, how much enlargement has taken place. Okay, so here, the severity of the attachment loss is generally, but not always correlated to the depth of the pocket. So here, the depth of the pocket is same, but the attachment loss here is different in three pictures. Okay, so the depth of the pocket is same in A, B and C, but the attachment loss is different because in B picture, we have some amount of recession. In C picture, we have some more amount of recession, but the pocket depth is same. So the severity of attachment loss cannot always be correlated with the depth of pocket. Okay, so now there are some important values that you have to remember. So the distance in between the apical, and these are the numerical values which you have to by heart. Okay, just note it down in a paper. You have to by heart those numerical aspects. Okay, so the distance in between the apical end of the junctional epithelium and alveolar bone is constant and it is 1.07 mm. This is again an important question. So the distance from the junctional epithelium to the alveolar bone is constant. So they will ask you this question. It's a straight question. It remains constant and it is 1.07 mm. And again, the distance in between the apical extent of the calculus to the alveolar crest is also constant and it is 1.97 mm with some variation. Okay. Distance in between the junctional epithelium to the bone is 1.07 mm, whereas the distance between the apical extent of the calculus to the bone is 1.97 mm. Next, the distance in between the attached plaque to the bone is never less than 0.5 mm and never more than 2.7 mm. That means it is in between 0.5 to 2.7 mm. So if you understand those areas that I have told, so first layer is calculus. Next is attached plaque. Next is unattached plaque. Next is junctional epithelium. Okay, next we have semi-lysed connective tissue fibers or the partially lysed connective tissue fibers. Next we have intact connective tissue fibers. So now we are talking about the distance in between the attached plaque to the bone. So this is on the tooth surface we are seeing. Okay, so here we have the gingiva, here we have the bone. So the distance in between the attached plaque to the bone is in between 0.5 to 2.7 mm. So this was given by Weyerhaeuser. Okay, so according to this Weyerhaeuser's concept, again, Page and Schroeder has given, you have to remember these authors' names. Okay, Page and Schroeder has given something called as radius of action. Okay, this radius of action is 1.5 to 2.5 mm. So they have stated that in between bacteria has to act, this bacteria will act at a distance of 1.5 to 2 mm. So if the bacteria are present, they will induce the changes. Okay, they will induce the pathologic changes within 1.5 to 2 mm. Okay, so this is called as radius of action, which was given by Page and Schroeder. I hope everyone is clear with the topic. Thank you, everyone. If you have any doubts, you can just ask me.
Yeah, Ramya, you can stop sharing your screen so that I can see everyone out there.
Yeah. Yeah. One second, I just missed one point. Zone.
Okay,
they are called as plaque-free zone in extracted teeth. So if you extract a tooth and if you see this area is called as plaque-free zone. Why? Because this plaque is, this unattached plaque is getting washed off. Okay, so here we have 3, 4, 5, where is the plaque is getting washed off. Junctional epithelium is there, partially connective tissue fibers are there. So this 3, 4, 5 areas are called as plaque-free zone in case of extracted teeth. Yeah, let's stop.
Yeah, so Suchanda, any doubt? Koi doubt hai Suchanda?
Nahi bhaiya.
Okay. Akash, Aniket, I'd like to share something with you. No, Aniket, Monojit, Hifzur, Mustafa, no doubts. Okay. Okay, so I would like to request Ramya from the next class, you can include some MCQs along with the presentation so that for the
new
students,
sure,
it will help them a lot. And they will get accustomed to MCQs also. Because when we... So when we see only through the slides, means there are lots of points which we don't know. Actually, they come in our MCQ. So I would like to recall from whatever you have taught some of the questions which come in exam. Okay, which have already come in exam. I'm reading from the Dental Pulse periodontal pocket chapter. Okay. So first question was that of pseudo pocket. So aapko pseudo pocket ke baare mein janna hai. Okay. Everyone, please study what is pseudo pocket. Okay. Then she told about lateral wall of pocket. Lateral wall, I think aapne gaur kiya hai ki nahi, something she told that this is important. So in periodontitis, maximum destruction is present in lateral wall of pocket. So please note down this one. कि पेरियोडोंटाइटिस में लेटरल वॉल सबसे ज्यादा अफेक्टेड होता है. लेटरल वॉल इज अफेक्टेड द मोस्ट इन पेरियोडोंटाइटिस. दिस शी टोल्ड इन हर लेक्चर. ओके, देन द नेक्स्ट वन इज पेरियोडोंटल पॉकेट में देयर इज प्लाज्मा सेल. आई थिंक 80% प्लाज्मा सेल, राइट रम्या? यू टोल्ड दैट वन. दैट इज ऑल्सो एन इम्पोर्टेंट क्वेश्चन. ओके, देन डिस्टेंस बिटवीन जंक्शनल एपिथिलियम एंड अल्वियोलर बोन, दैट ऑल्सो शी टोल्ड. That is 1.07 mm. So this also comes, this also has come actually in your exam before. Okay. Then what is the constituent of periodontal pocket? That is microorganism, their product and debris. So you have to remember this. Okay. Then period of quiescence and exacerbation. She told that one also. This has also come in your exam. So please note down that one also. Then what is compound periodontal pocket? Periodontal ligament pocket present on two or more surface. This one also he has told. So please note down that one also. Then difference between gingivitis and periodontitis. That is loss of epithelial attachment. Then what is infrabony pocket? Then what is exotoxin? Exotoxin is obtained from bacteria. Then proliferative and degenerative changes. I think she put emphasis on that also, ki proliferative and degenerative changes hota hai. So isko bhi aap note down kar lo, theek hai? Then distance between bottom of calculus and alveolar crest. She told that is 1.97 mm. So this is also important. Please note down. Then apical penetration of the probe, depth of clinical gingival sulcus. This also she told. Then what is pseudopocket? Pseudopocket is seen in gingivitis. Okay. And then supracrestal, suprabony pocket. This also she told. So most of the questions of the chapter periodontal pocket has been covered by Dr. Ramya in her class. But you have to go through the class nicely. And after going through the class, please go through the questions present in Dental Pulse, Dentist, whatever you are reading, and note down. And also the synopsis part. Many of the things she taught, like radius of action, it's not there in the chapter itself, but it is there in the synopsis part. So, aap waha se radius of action, like it is 1.5 to 2 mm, right, Ramya?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, radius.
So, in bone loss and bone loss patterns and destruction, also we'll get some, some questions in from this intrabony pockets, one wall defects, two wall defects.
Yes,
so,
yes.
In that, we'll cover the radius of action once again, actually.
Yeah. So, yeah, radius of action, bhi, Ramya, Dr. Ramya ne bataya hai. So, please note down that one also, okay? And from next class, I would request Ramya, please get some MCQs. I'll send you some MCQs. I have prepared MCQs. So I'll send you them and you can explain them. Okay. And okay, then everyone, if you have any doubt, please feel free to share. If you can send in the chat box or you can directly speak also. If you have any doubt, please go through the periodontal pocket chapter. Agar third year ho, final year ho, you study the textbook. And for the interns, I would request you to please go through the Dental Pulse. All the questions are almost solved in the class. Okay. So, theek hai fir, if no one has...
One of the...
Yeah.
I have a question that ma'am told... Asna, that which organ microorganism is involved in that root caries?
Actinomyces. It is Actinomyces viscosus.
Yes.
Actinomyces.
I think Israeli is also
Yeah,
Actinomyces.
Right? Yeah.
Ramya?
What is the name of the
so
microorganism?
The dominant organism is Actinomyces viscosus. Okay, there are other species like even the Actinomyces nasalundi, Streptococcus mutans. So all these are there, but the main organism that you have to remember is Actinomyces viscosus, which is involved, which is a dominant microorganism in root surface caries.
Okay, so Manojit, it is Actinomyces viscosus. Okay, please remember it.
Okay.
This is an important question actually. It comes in the exam. Okay.
Yeah. And these areas where this cementum is getting necrotic, no? So whenever we place probe, it will be painful to the patient. So this is one thing. Actually, it is not asked, but it's just for your knowledge that I'm sharing. So this is the area when we probe, it will be very painful to the patient. Yeah.
And one more thing, which is very important, she told this. I think this is the surface morphology. This attached plaque, unattached plaque. This diagram, you please practice. This is very important. I'm requesting all the students to practice that diagram. And this, the first diagram she told, junctional epithelium and all those structures, sulcular epithelium. These things come in exam. Okay, for the final years, third years, isko to janna hi hai. And interns, this come as a image-based question. So please note down that one also. Okay.